kissed me, hugged me, clothed me, fed me, whipped me, and all that fun. But more than that, remember we were riding around feeling fancy in that gold mines, the 626, bumping A-ball MJG, just like candy. And Mrs. Furlough, my main thing. She said, my one.
Good morning. Good morning. Hey, y'all. Hey. Wow. Good morning. Good morning. How y'all doing? Good morning. Good morning. See y'all, Deshauna and Marianne and Tammy and Chala, Roz and Miss Vicky and Juana. Hey, Demi. Hey, Arius. Good morning. How y'all doing this morning? Hey, girl. Hey. Hey, girl. Hey. I'm blinging. It always reflects off of here. It's my Coffee and Conversations with LaKisha t-shirt. They are for sale if you want one. My coffee mug this morning is listening to my son's music. My coffee mug this morning says this girl is on fire. So let me tell y'all how silly I am in my house is. My silverware keeps disappearing. So I needed to stir my coffee. So this is my spoon. Like I couldn't find a spoon, so I just said. And I've caught my kids eating with this spoon. Like, we just do some random strange stuff. Like, it just doesn't matter sometimes, I think, with us. We just do some random strange stuff. I know, isn't that crazy? Like, I was like, okay, this is the spoon I'm using this morning. Good morning, Tammy from Kansas City. I was like, oh, well, it works. So I don't know. Like, I don't know what the deal is with spoons and silverware in my house. I cannot buy any of my silverware. Ross, and it's a good spoon, too. Like, it's not a cheap spoon either. The other day, I was eating some yogurt with it, and my son was looking at me like, you gonna try to eat yogurt with this big old spoon? I was trying to wedge it into the container and eat it. Hey, Uncle Frankie. So, I mean, it is what it is. Like, I needed a spoon. I wasn't going to sit and try to find one. Hey, Marie. Hey, baby. How you doing? Are you finished with finals yet? Let me take a sip of this coffee and pray so we can get started. Hey, the Johnson household. Like, know about this wireless port connection. Can y'all see me? See, I got something powerful to teach today. I haven't had any problem with my connection. Hey, Vivica, can y'all see me with no problem? Is it clear? Like, I ain't had no problem with reception at all lately. All right, good. Good morning. Go welcome. Go share this video live right now. Like, go share it live. Let me pray and let's get started for today. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your grace, your mercy, your peace. We thank you for your love this morning. We thank you for your outstanding favor. Favor that produces supernatural increase. Favor that causes policies, rules, and everything to be reversed for our advantage. We thank you, Father God, for supernatural increase and promotion today. Bless the people today. Let the word not fall on deaf ears, that it be implanted in their hearts, that they're able to go and multiply the kingdom for your glory. And let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, I'm telling you, hey, Tammy, hey, Shanice. Awesome, Marie. I'm so proud of you. I'm so, so proud of you. Like, so proud of you. Because I know the story. So I just wanted you to know how proud of you I am for persevering, for pushing, for staying in faith, for continuing to be a woman of God and overcoming the obstacles around you and finishing your finals with no problem. I'm super, super proud of you, Marie. Super proud of you. All right. So I am in this thing today, and I want to talk to you. When I left yesterday and we started talking about David, the Lord started sharing with me some excerpts of some things I am book writing. I'm actually working on one book mentally, right? And the other book that I'm finishing up is a Christian fiction book. So hopefully my Christian fiction book will be finished by the end of the year. The Lord showed me how delayed I had been in writing this book, and I was really being a chump and not getting it done. So I'm gonna get this book done. Like, I gotta get this book done without like anything. Like, I can't keep playing. I can't keep playing at all with this book. And then the other book that I'm working on is called Do the Work. And it's for the minister, the entrepreneur, the business person. I don't know how, if people really understand how I have this heart for entrepreneurs, whether starting. See, people who start ministries don't even realize that they are entrepreneurs. They're building. They think entrepreneurs mean I'm just building a business. But even when you launch and start a ministry, you're an entrepreneur. You've decided to walk this thing out in God. You've decided to take a bold leap. You've decided to walk into your destiny, the call, the thing that's on your life. And I've shared with you multiple times that our calls are not just situated, or they are not just for us. We are called to our mountains, our spheres of influence. Our pastor has been teaching that. Some of us think that some of us will go into the restaurant business. Some of us will go into these areas. And the thing is, so that God's light is shined through us, that we are the city on the hill, that we're not hidden, and he is getting the ultimate glory. Some of you will work in corporate America, and the whole plan is for you to work in corporate America so that you're able to, right, be the light in corporate America. And we got to understand that, like, people have been teaching us ministry behind the pulpit, ministry in the church, and we are the church. We are priests, we are kings. Like, we are part of the royal priesthood, and this is biblical in the Bible. And you've got to begin to understand who you are, what your position is, how your gifts and talents tie into this, so that you can go out and multiply the kingdom. There is somebody else waiting on you. Like, there's somebody else waiting on you. Your story, your situation, what you've been through is going to it's going to create an avalanche or a windfall of multiplication of the kingdom. Can I tell you something? I told y'all I have just very different kids in the house. And Josiah came to me the other day and he says, "Mom, my Bible teacher was teaching me that there are 3 billion Christians." And he said, "Can you imagine that if 3 billion Christians, if we all just shared our story, how quickly we could multiply the kingdom for our glory? If we all just got out and started discipling, how quickly we could multiply the kingdom for God's glory?" He said, "We should be gaining leverage, gaining territory, multiplying, growing the kingdom. What is wrong if there's 3 billion Christians? Why are things moving so slow?" And I told him, I said, "Josiah, because a lot of people are not in position. A lot of people are not walking into their call. A lot of people are not moving into the things that they're supposed to move into because of fear, being scared, worry, not thinking that they have enough resources." And I think that's the thing that has us blocked and immovable, and we'll partially walk into what God called us. We'll only receive part of what he said. So today is a two-part series. I don't think I'm going to preach this thing. I think this thing is going to come in a teaching format. You're going to want pen and paper today. You're going to want pen and paper today if you don't have it. You're going to want to be able to take notes in your phone, because I'm going to talk to you for the next 2 days about slaying giants. And I'm going to talk to you about the giants that we face as we move out into position into what God called us to. There is opposition for this. I'm telling you, the enemy is not interested in you walking in this thing and allowing you to have this thing freely. He isn't, because what he knows is if you get into position, then those multiplication for the kingdom is going to come. And so right now he wants you out of position. He wants you out of position. And so many of us have fallen into the hands of what he said. Like, we don't get into full position, and we don't even understand how important our position is to the kingdom. Like, we don't even understand it. I remember one time I was sitting in the class, and my sociology teacher was teaching me. She said, LaKisha, there is an order to all of this. She said, there is an order to all of this. She said, if people will just get into position and people will stop thinking that they're the least in the kingdom, because they're not the least in the kingdom. If everybody will get into position, everybody will serve everybody, then the cups become overflow because we're constantly pouring into each other. So today's a two-part series. So I'm going to tell you this. Anytime you're getting ready to walk out into your calling, your purpose, you cannot do this without the Holy Spirit. John 14 and 26 says, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and make you remember all that I have told you. And for some reason, we get afraid or scared of the Holy Spirit, and we don't want to bring him in this. But you got to walk into the boldness of what this is in your partnership with the Holy Spirit. Like, you know, Zechariah 4 and 6 says, not by your power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. And what the Lord is trying to show you in this, there is a partnership. It's God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. That's a part of your partnership. When I went and watched Devon Franklin, he said something that moved me. He said, y'all stop waiting on people to confirm you. He said, the only confirmation that you need for this thing that God is calling you into is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They already confirmed you. They already approved you. And I was like, he's right. So many of us are hesitant. We're hesitant to fully walk in. Can I tell y'all something? You know, I like sharing my own story. I remember for the longest when I accepted my call and I started walking in my call, Jermaine was really challenging me because I did not want to identify that God had called me into ministry. Like, I didn't want to call it ministry, because when you're a woman in ministry, people shun you. When you're a woman in ministry, people have an idea of what a woman in ministry is supposed to look like. And so it was very hard for me to identify that this thing was a ministry that God was calling me into, because of the perception of women in ministry, of how people thought about them. It was just crazy. And Jermaine just would call me out all the time. And he was like, you just ain't gonna call this space. You just ain't gonna tell people you licensed and ordained. You just not gonna get in this. You gonna just say you at work and you teaching and you doing this thing. Like, you don't want, but I'm telling you, it's the perception that came with it. And as bold as I am, it was still hard for me to acknowledge what the Lord was saying to me, what he was calling me into and what he's doing, for fear of how people already perceived this role. It's even now when I come in contact with people, sometimes I can see people looking at me and it's real spooky spiritual, right? And when people are looking at me real spooky spiritual, or they feel like I'm about to give them a word, and I don't even act like that. Like, when I'm around my friends, I'm around my friends. If the Lord gives me something to say, yes. But when we together, we dumb, we stupid. Keep up with my Instagram. We have a blast. We have a great time. And so it was very hard for me to walk into what God was calling me to do. And I'm relatable because of the idea. Yes, Chala, for real, the idea or the expectation. So when I first even started this, I was just going to be LaKisha M. Johnson, the motivational speaker. And the Lord was like, keep calling me that. I was just going to be the motivational speaker, the life coach, the mentor. And I just kept playing with it. Like, I just kept leaving it there. And the Lord just kept saying, this is your ministry. And I need you to identify it for what it is, because I've called you into a very unique ministry, a very transparent ministry. We're going to be hands-on into the street. I'm calling you to in a ministry for the people that are sick and tired of regular church. Like, this is your ministry, and you need to stop playing like you have not been called into ministry. And then he just start calling me out everywhere I went. Like, different people, I was like, what is going on here? And that's why I told you, when you're earmarked, the Lord is going to call you out. You can try to hide behind a rock. You can try to pretend like you're someone else. You can name and call this thing something else. But whatever the Lord has earmarked you for, That's what he's calling you into. And so you can try to figure it out because it sounds more professional and more accepting. But the Lord said, if you deny me, LaKisha, if you keep denying this thing so that you can be comfortable with other people, then really what you're doing is denying. You're denying what I called you to. And if I formed you in your mother womb and I shaped you and I called you this, then you can't sit and modify and water it down, or you're watering me down. You're rejecting what I'm saying to you is so. And so I had to come to the end of myself, which was dealing with my pride, and accept this thing and call this thing at what it is. Like, call this thing what it is. Call it what it is. And I had to make an all-in decision to say, you know what, Lord? I'm all in. And if somebody can't accept my all-in, then I've got to be okay with this. And I'm going to clearly let you know. Every t-shirt I create is for a reason. Like, every t-shirt you see on my website is for a reason. I am sent me. Man, call your gift exactly what it is, not what makes us comfortable. That's so important. So today, I want to talk to you a little bit about some giants that we face as we're moving into position. There are giants that you will face as God is calling you out, calling you into your sphere of influence, whatever that is. The Lord began to show me this, and this is going in my book, Do the Work. There are giants that you will begin to face. And the very first giant that we're going to deal with today is the moneyless giant. Like, the moneyless giant. This giant faces you, gives you great opposition. You can't seem to get around it. You don't have enough resources for what the Lord is calling you to do. The Lord has called you out, told you to start this business, told you to start this ministry, told you to start this nonprofit organization, and you absolutely have no money for this. You don't have enough money. You don't have any money, and you are sitting here trying to figure out, and I told you yesterday, it's about what's in your hand. Lord, how am I going to accomplish this? And that moneyless giant seems to give us the most opposition. Like, it seems to present us with so much opposition because we need resources for what we're about to do. And so it's huge. It's opposing. It's a force. It's in the road, right? You don't have what you need to do what you need to accomplish. God is birthing. He's giving you the vision. You're writing it all down. You need it. You hear him. You know it's time to go. Your timing is right. And the Lord is telling you to launch, and you got $2.50 in your bank account. Like, he's telling you to, and you got $2.50 in your bank account. And the Lord is saying, start this thing. And you're like, what? How am I supposed to start what you're telling me to start? And I don't have enough in my hands. How am I supposed to go where you're telling me to go? You've told me to be the lender and not the borrower. I'm not trying to get in debt for this thing. So how am I supposed to go when you tell me to go? How am I supposed to create this? How am I supposed to do this? And the Lord has given us strategies. Can I tell you something? The Lord has given you strategies for this moneyless giant, a lack of resources. And for the sake of time, I'm telling you, I cannot read every last one of these scriptures. So I'm going to give the scriptures to you. That's why I told you, you got to write it down. This is how you defeat the moneyless giant. This is how you overcome the moneyless giant. Stewardship, tithing, and sowing. Stewardship, tithing, and sowing. There is a wisdom that will come to you when you learn how to master your finances. And I'm being serious. Stewardship, tithing, and sowing. There is a wisdom. God will give a wisdom to you when you learn how to master your finances. He cannot increase you until you learn biblical principles on tithing, sowing, and giving. Now, some people will say tithing is Old Testament, right? Tithing is Old Testament. I don't want to deal with tithing. I don't have to deal with tithing. That's fine. You ain't got to deal with tithing. If you decide that tithing is not for you, it's Old Testament, you don't want to, I'm a tither. One of the reasons that I tithe is because it keeps me honest. Now, I will tell you this, 1 Corinthians 4:1-2, Matthew 25:23, 1 Corinthians 16:2, 1 Corinthians 9:6-7. All of those are scriptures that are going to justify what I tell you. The Lord told us to give liberally. He did not tell us to give sparingly. He said in his word, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. If you will get into the principles of tithing, sowing, and stewardship, if you will learn to manage what you have, I am truly a believer that God will increase you. Like, he's going to increase you. He's going to put more. He's going to set you up. He's going to make you the conduit. But God cannot put what he needs in your hands if you cannot be a ruler and a master over what he already gave you. And so this moneyless giant challenges your stewardship, your tithing, and your sowing. I'm telling you, every time you launch out into ministry or business or whatever, there's tests that come. There are tests that come. And so a test will occur. A test will occur to see what you're going to do. If the Lord has already told you to give, and then your tire blows, or something happens, or something comes up, and the Lord has already told you an amount to give, and you have to stop and think, well, do I give this amount, or I choose to do something else? You need to do exactly what God told you to do in regards to your stewardship, tithing, and sowing. He will give more to the one that takes care of what God has him. You can't be asking God to increase you financially, right? You can't be asking him to increase him financially and you're not being obedient at the level right here. Like, he's told you to sow. He's told you to give. He told you to give liberally. He told you to take care of the poor. He's already told you those things. And if he's told you those things and he's given you those things as assignment, until you do those things, it's going to be very difficult for the increase to come. He gave me some assignments. That's why I'm telling you, you got to know. He said, my sheep know my voice. That's why you have to be tapped into the Holy Spirit. That's why you got to have a relationship with him. That's why you got to spend time in his word. So if you want to defeat the moneyless giant, so stewardship, tithing, and sowing. And I promise you, the increase is going to come. He said, give and it shall be given unto you. Pressed down, shaken together, runneth over, shall men give into your bosom. I truly believe divinely that God will set the right people in place. If you're in obedience, if you walk this thing out, and your tithing, your stewardship, and your giving is where and what God told, and you don't justify. Can I tell y'all something? When I had nothing, I never ever came before the Lord empty-handed. And I'm talking about sometimes it was pennies. Sometimes it was pennies. Sometimes it was a quarter. Sometimes I remember one time I put 42 cents in church. But I made a decision that no matter what, I will never come before the Lord empty-handed. I will never, ever come before him empty-handed. And I'm not giving him, I'm not kicking it. I'm not partying. I'm not doing some things. I'm not. Can I tell y'all something? Y'all know how I feel about my hands, my nails, and my feet. I've talked about it before. I put my nails and feet on pause right now, only for special events, because I have a goal to get out of debt. And I told the Lord, in order for me to get out of debt, I will sacrifice these vain things that I love to put myself in the position to get out of debt. When you give it to me, I'm going to earmark it, put it where it needs to go so that I can get out of debt. So I'm going to make some vain sacrifices to get myself out of debt. And I don't go without getting my hands and my feet done. That's not my thing. But I've been believing for him for increase. And when the increase comes, I want it to go where it needs to go because I don't want to be in debt. Like, I don't want to be in debt. I got rid of my cable. I went to a fire stick. Like, I just begin to adjust myself because I want to get out of debt. I want to practice what I'm teaching you guys. I want to be honest and integrity and character in my ministry so that I can get out of debt. I want to get out of debt. I can go continue to do those things, but I want to get out of debt. And if I'm going to get there, I've got to put myself in a position so that I can get out of debt. They'll be taken care of, Odell. I don't do nothing raggedy. I know how to take care of my own feet and hands. Believe me that I'm a lady. But I'm looking at strategies and principles to get myself out of debt as he increases. So if you want to beat that moneyless giant, stewardship, tithing, and sowing, Right? So it says, let a man regard us in this manner as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. In this case, moreover, it is required of stewards that one be found trustworthy. That's in the Bible. That's in the Bible, that one be found trustworthy. And so for you to be able to be found trustworthy, right? For you to be able to be found trustworthy, then it's in your stewardship and your giving and your tithe. Like, if you will make sure you manage your finances, he's going to increase you financially. He's not going to increase you financially, and you're wasteful. And some of y'all are like, well, I'm doing fine. I ain't got a tithe. I don't believe in that, and I'm doing fine, and God is blessing me. You know what? I talked to the Lord one time, and I'm just being real. One time I was sitting there, and I was talking to God, and I was like, man, why is it seem like that everybody else can do whatever they want, but when I try to do stuff outside your will, calamity strikes? You know what he said to me? He said, I might not be their daddy. And I was like, oh, he's like, everybody that say, Lord, Lord, don't enter the kingdom. Everybody that tell you they love God and serve me, I may not be truly God in their life. I may be God in action and words and a few scriptures that they push on the board. He said, but I really may not be God. I really may not be their daddy. I really may not be their father. Because if I'm truly their father, then these things that I've asked, if I've told them to give, then they're not going to question my giving. If I told them to take care of these kids, these babies, if I told them to take care of the poor, if I told them to do that, sometimes y'all sit around and think because someone is so blessed that they're blessed by me. And it doesn't mean that that person is being blessed by me. That's not what that means, that they're being blessed by me. That doesn't mean. So I might not really be their daddy. I might not be God in their life. I might not be their Lord. So stop watching what it seems like. So if somebody is not operating and you're not seeing their fruit, you're not seeing their fruit, because it should be evidence, the things, or you're not seeing them move and do the things that I've asked them to do, then I might not really be their daddy. Like, I might not really be their Lord and Savior. I might not really be their God. That don't stop thinking because people acknowledge me means that I'm their God. They ain't gonna have no problem. If a person is connected and they serve the Father and they know who he is, they're not gonna have a problem doing any of the things that I just told you at all. They're not, because wealth, they understand that wealth and riches is in his hand, in his hand. And they understand that without a doubt. They understand wealth is riches is in his hands. What? Guess what? That's it for today. I think that's enough for you to chew on. The scriptures that I gave you are the ones you need to meditate on today. Ask the Holy Spirit how to show you. The Lord told me to give you one more. Hold on. I got one more. I asked the Lord to show you. There's one more giant we're going to talk about today, and that's the giant of doubt, fear, and worry. That's the giant of doubt, fear, and worry. And doubt, fear, and worry go hand in hand. Doubt, fear, and worry. Doubt, fear, and worry is like a three-headed giant. That's what the Holy Spirit was showing me when I was writing this. Doubt, fear, and worry is like a three-headed giant. And the goal of doubt, fear, and worry is to confuse you. That's the goal. The goal of doubt, fear, and worry is to confuse you. And so let me tell you what happens with them. You've made a decision. They're like a three-headed giant. The Lord showed me this spiritually. He said they're like a three-headed giant. And so you made this decision that I'm going to walk out of my call. God, I'm going to serve you like nothing else. I'm all in. Like, I'm all in. I'm doing this thing that you called me to do no matter what. And doubt, fear, and worry, which are this three-headed giant, they will begin to talk to you. And the idea is for them to confuse your brain and your head so that you don't walk. All three of them start talking to you at the exact same time. And so it's almost like you hear multiple voices in your head. Like, it's almost like you hear multiple voices in your head, and you know you've heard what God said, you've accepted what he said, and then doubt, fear, and worry set in. And the goal of doubt, fear and worry, the reason that they set in was ultimately to keep you confused so that you wouldn't walk into the fullness of what God has told you to do. Can I tell you something? There's a few things that I need you to do in order to defeat doubt, fear, and worry. One, don't talk to anyone else about your vision until it's time. Don't talk to anyone else about your vision until it's time. The Lord will give you a timing of when to release your vision. Habakkuk 2 and 2 says, write it out. Rewrite it. Write it over again. Write it multiple times. Do not talk. Because here's the thing. If you are talking to people who are not filled in faith and who do not understand or have the vision in your life, and especially if these are people of authority in your life, your parents, your girlfriends, even your husband. I'm just going to be real. Even your husband. If God is not, there is a specific time that the Lord will tell you to share this vision. Can I tell you something? An amateur will talk about it. And I know, especially with our spouses, but if our spouses are not at the same spiritual level or at the level we are, if you talk too soon, they'll start saying to you. But if you take the vision, write it out, put it before you, and really spend time praying over it, then what's going to happen for you is God is going to begin to put you in the position, and they will begin to move. See, the heart of the king is in God's hand. And even when somebody has told you no, or they don't look there in alignment with you, I'm telling you, God has the power. God has the power to move a person who will tell you they won't move. So doubt, fear, and worry. So don't talk. Genesis 37, read the story about Joseph. Joseph, even though God redeemed him, I truly believe he should have sat and chewed on that before he began to talk about it. His brothers weren't ready to receive that. They were already envious of him. He already had this coat of multiple colors. You need to sit and write it out, keep rewriting it, pray about it, keep bathing it in prayer, because doubt, fear, and worry are going to set in, and they usually come through the people that we trust most. They're going to come through those people. They're going to start talking. Can I tell you something? And I'm just going to be real. When we started our nonprofit organization and Jermaine came to me with the nonprofit organization, I said to him it wouldn't work. I told him it wouldn't work. Like, I was like, this is too much. You're trying to do something that we can't do. I told him it wouldn't work. I was an immature wife, and I did not understand how powerful my words were. I told him it wouldn't work. And here we are 14 years later, and it's working. And everything that he set out to do, accomplished. Now, I got myself together along the way. I repented of my words, but he should have sat on it a little longer, because I wasn't mature enough as his wife to see the vision at that time. I hadn't been in prayer. I wasn't at the right level. And so when he first told me, I said, it ain't gonna work. You're trying to do something we don't even have the capacity to do. And then the Lord began to deal with me in my personal self. The second time, I told you, spend time in prayer. He will give you the strategies for it all. So doubt, how you combat doubt, fear, and worry is when you spent the time in prayer, the Lord will begin to give you the strategies for it. Once he gives you the strategies for it, you will know what to do. The Holy Spirit has got to become your best friend. The Holy Spirit has got to become your very best friend. Like, you and the Holy Spirit, that's your G right there. The Holy Spirit is your G. That's your ride or die. Your Holy Spirit has got to become your best friend. My sheep know my voice. The Lord is going to talk to you. The Holy Spirit will begin to give you every strategy you need. Like, every strategy you need, every assignment. Read the story of Gideon, Judges 6 through 8. When the Lord started, when they started talking, read it, he's going to give you the strategies that you need. He'll give you every strategy you need. You just need to make sure you're tapped into the Holy Spirit. That's how you combat doubt, fear, and worry, and prayer. Philippians 4, 6, and 8 tells us, be anxious for nothing, everything in prayer and supplication. A lot of us don't want to spend the time in prayer. We don't. We want the Lord. He tells us, and then we want to run. And we got to sit that thing and bathe that thing in prayer. I'm talking about sometimes you got to put your hands on it and just pray until you get a release. thanking the Lord for the vision, asking him for the clarity, asking him for the wisdom and the knowledge, asking him for the timing so that you don't launch something too quickly, so that you don't launch something, wait, because if you launch it too quickly, you're going to give up. You're going to have a premature birth. If you have a premature birth, this thing is going to fail. So read the story of Gideon. Look at what happened with Gideon. Look at how he gave him the strategies for what he needed to defeat this army with just a little bit in his hand. But he had to be in a position to be able to hear what the Lord was saying without a doubt. Like, he had to be in the position to hear what the Lord was saying without a doubt. But it had to be spent in time, in prayer, and in relationship with him. You are not in a rush. You're not in a rush. Third giant, anxiety. And we're closing it out after anxiety. The third giant that you're going to face is anxiety. That's the third giant you're going to face. And these may come in a different order for you. I'm just telling you what the Lord showed. The third giant that you're going to face is anxiety. Can I tell you the goal behind anxiety? The entire goal behind anxiety is to get you to move too soon. That's the anxiety wants you so anxious that you will move too soon. Oh, if I don't do this right now, that's the whole goal of anxiety. And it usually follows doubt, fear, and worry. Anxiety makes you feel like you're delayed. Anxiety makes you feel like you haven't accomplished enough. Anxiety makes you attach to things you don't have any business attaching to. That's what anxiety did. You can read Exodus 2:11 and 15, Acts 7:23 and 30, and Hebrews 11:24 and 30. Can I tell you something? Moses didn't see the promised land because of his anxiety, because of his unsettledness, because of his ability to trust God in his word. His anxiety got the best of them. They got the best of him, like the best of him. They got the best. His anxiety gets the best of you. That's what happens. Anxiety also causes you to compare yourself to other people. Anxiety will cause you to compare yourself to other people. Can I show you something? In Luke 15 and 28 and 31, when the older brother is sitting there, right? When the prodigal son returns home, and the older brother simply says to him, he says, "You know what? Why is it that you're doing all of this for him? Like, why are you doing this? Why do you have this going on for him? Why are you doing this? He left you, and I stayed right here with you, and I've lived right, and I've done things the way that you're supposed to do." And the Lord and the father simply turns and says to him, "Son, you've been with me the entire time. You get all these benefits. You have everything that you need standing here. Everything that you have, you're walking in what I called you to do for this season. You have all the benefits that come with walking with me. Why are you worried about how I bless him and what I do?" But he was getting anxious. He was anxious of the relationship between him and God. You can never become anxious of the relationship between you and God. If you're doing the right things, keep doing the right things. Stay in your own lane. MYOB, mind your own business, and don't worry about what anything to do. But an anxious spirit, see, anxiety heightens you. I've been anxious before. I used to have anxiety attacks. Anxiety heightens you, and it forces you to make decisions you necessarily wouldn't make. It'll force you to form partnerships that you have no business forming. It'll force you to marry people that you aren't ready to marry because anxiety occurs, and you're trying, "Oh my gosh, am I too late? Do I need to do this?" And so anxiety occurs. And I'm telling you, once anxiety occurs, it'll put you in a position to do things that you're, because you're anxious. And when you're anxious, you're very unstable. When you're anxious, people who have anxiety attacks are very unstable people. I'm all, like, a person that is having an anxiety attack will take you out of here. They will, because they're going to fight you. They're going to fight. They're irrational. They're not thinking. They're anxious. They're heightened. Their energy levels are up. That their energy levels are up. So the other giant is anxiety. And that goal of that giant is to make you move too quickly. I need to do this. Or you'll see somebody else coming. You'll see somebody else coming out with something the Lord told you to do. Oh, no, I got to hurry up and release what the Lord told me to release. And the Lord has told you it's not time to release it right now. But you're trying to release it because you think what somebody else is doing around you is going to work. And the problem is, you don't need to be worried about what anybody else around you is doing. You do not need to release. Only in the timing that God gave for you should you be released. Only in that timing. Because when he does it, that's what he was trying to show Moses. Moses became anxious because of the noise of the people. The people was like, Lord told him, don't tap that rock. Lord, Moses tapped that rock again anyway. Because of the anxiety, because of what people were saying. Why haven't you gone back to school today? Why haven't you done that? Why haven't you got married yet? Like, what's wrong with you? Why you ain't married? Like, what? And then you go marry somebody that you don't even like, that you ain't even interested in, that you don't even care about, that you don't even want to be with. But because of what people were saying, it's made you so anxious, you've leapt too soon. Or you go start a business and you don't even have the wherewithal and the wisdom for business. Or you try to go to school and you know you already stretched too thin, but you're going to go to school because anxiety has you feeling like you insufficient. That's what else anxiety does. It makes you feel like you're insufficient. And so when you're feeling insufficient, but God has already told you my grace, everything that I have is sufficient enough for you. Like, it's sufficient enough for you. Casey, more of us are worried about what people say than we will realize. And we'll say, oh, I do. I march the beat to my own drum. I'm not messed up about what nobody else think. A lot of us are out of position because of the fear of what people will think. We won't do what we're supposed to do because fear, doubt, and worry has confused us and we've made a rush decision. Some of y'all have disconnected from the things that you're supposed to connect to because of anxiety. Anxiety got the best of you. Oh, how can I handle this? What am I going to be able to do? Anxiety gets the best of you. And I'm telling you, fear, doubt, and worry is one giant. And then anxiety comes right behind and floods you. And it gives you an unsureness. And when you're unsure, then you make rash decisions that make absolutely none. Anxiety. My son got in trouble. I got anxious. So every time something happened to him, I got anxious and I just started charging to get him out of trouble. Well, had I sought the Lord already had a strategy for it. The Holy Spirit already had a strategy, but it appealed to my mother's heart. And because as a mother, I'm about my kids and I love my kids intensely. I felt like I needed to jump in every time and bail them out. And some of that stuff, I didn't need to jump in and bail him out. Some of the stuff, I needed to be out the way and allow him to build his relationship, his trust, and his faith in God. Like, and it's just being real. And it's just being real. Well, that really is it for today. That's it for today. We're going to deal with these other two giants tomorrow. We're going to deal with these other two giants tomorrow. I hope that is a blessing to you today for the entrepreneur, for the minister. That's even for your marriage. You can take everything that I taught today and apply it in so many areas of your life. There's a wisdom to this. God has set you up to succeed. The enemy wants you to fail. God is not going to call you something to something and you fail. That's not what he's going to do. He's not going to do it. So my confession over you today is that you walk in God's wisdom and perfect will for your life. I don't want you to accept anything less than the very best. Those giants, Moneyless, doubt, fear, worry, and anxiety, their goal is to get you out the will of God so that you don't accept his very best for your life. And the Lord is like, no, I want you to walk into the very best for your life. You live the best life in Christ. See, and we see other people successful in ministry and business and all, and it's because they figured out how to defeat the giants and how to stay on the path that God told them. You got to combat those giants with the word. You got to combat. Prayer is your key to fighting doubt, fear, and worry. I want to give you a little tidbit, and I want to just share this a little bit. When you start speaking scripture to doubt, fear, and worry, you confuse them and they will turn on themselves. When you start speaking scripture to doubt, fear, and worry, you will confuse them and they will turn on themselves. The Lord showed me this spiritually. He showed me this spiritually. He said, all y'all got to do is slow down, be anxious for nothing, everything in prayer and supplication. Pull your weapon out. That's why I told you to guard yourself with your armor. What does your truth say about this situation? And if you start speaking scripture and start fortifying and building yourself up in the word, doubt, fear, and worry become confused and they turn on themselves. And then then their focus is off you because there's a spirit associated with them. They want you oppressed. They want you depressed. They want you to think that there's absolutely no way out of this situation and that God will not do anything for you. They want you downtrodden. They want you overwhelmed. That's why it's three that come at you at one time. But if you will learn your truth, your principle, your word, and you get enough scripture in you, when them jokers start coming to you and you start combating them with the word, they'll turn on themselves and they'll forget all about you. There is a burden lifting that comes when you know the word and use the word to your advantage. That's the sword of the spirit. And it'll chop, lacerate, and cut up anything that it needs to. But you gotta be praying, and you gotta be in your word. You gotta know what to use on them. Find every scripture on doubt. Can I tell you something? Fear not is in the Bible 365 times. The Lord says, fear not, I am with you. Lo, behold, fear not, I am with you. Yep, Sharon, steal your mind with the word. And at first it'll seem like it's not working, but layer after layer, you'll get better at this and you'll be able to walk in the fullness of what he calls you to do. It's your weapon. It's your tool. That's why the Lord don't want you to have study time. That's why sometimes when y'all use, it's cool to use those little Bible doubt belts. It's cute. It's cool, right? It's cool for you to use those little Bible apps that send you one scripture. But I want you to get in the habit of asking the Holy Spirit to show you what to study today. Like, the Bible app, mate, is cool. I ain't saying you don't use it, but you need to find a study plan. But I want you to get in the habit and say, Holy Spirit, Lord, show me what I need for this day. He loads us with daily benefits. Show me what I need this day. Because you wait and you slow down and you let him give you the scripture for this day, speak to me about this situation. Speak to me about this day. He'll prepare you for something that's coming at you. And when it comes at you, you already got the weapon for it. But if you keep moving, and you don't stop and allow, and you just doing. See, we can have a relationship with Christ and the Bible scripture come up and we read that and it sounds all good, but that's not what you even need to equip you for this day. He's trying to lead you into another word and another scripture. You got to get up in the morning and pray, Lord, arrest my mind and my thoughts and let me study what you need to give me for this day. And something will come to your heart and your mind. Stay on your Bible plans. I ain't saying don't stay on your Bible plans. Something will come to your heart and your mind without a doubt, and he will begin to give you what you need for this particular and present situation. I promise he will. So that's why you got to ask him. Oh, Destiny, let me say, Destiny said, what do you do if you want to sow into someone or something, but your spouse is unsure due to finances looking idea? Pray over Destiny, because you really need to do it in agreement with your spouse. But pray over it. Pray over your spouse and ask the Lord. We don't spend enough time praying over our spouses and our people. Pray over your spouse and ask the Lord to show them this. Do you know if you pray over your spouse and ask the Lord to show them and you get out the way and you get out the way and you shut up and you don't say anything else? The Lord will begin to speak to your spouse about the situation. He can bring it to him in a dream. He can bring it through a conversation. He will speak to your spouse about the situation. I promise you he will. But we try to force situations and we really need to spend time in prayer. Let me confess over you today. I'm confessing over you to walk in God's wisdom and his perfect will for your life. Yes, Vivica, it does. So if you spend the time really praying before you move, the Lord's going to honor the fact that you said you will. Like, Lord, I'm trying to honor you and my spouse isn't in agreement, but I want to honor you. Show him how this is going to work. Show him how to do this. Give them the vision and then get out the way. Close your mouth. See, as wives, we talk too much. We think we got to say it all. And the Lord is trying to tell us, put a guard over your mouth. Put your prayers in the earth. And I promise you, God will move him through your prayers. God will. I was more resistant. See, that's what people don't know. This is, you see me from the work. I was the one always more resistant in my marriage than Jermaine was. And Jermaine figured out how to deal with me. He said, anytime I tried to combat or come at you aggressively, you always did the opposite. He said, but anytime I got my, because your heart was towards God, anytime I got quiet, boy, your butt would move like lightning. He would present the idea, and then he would just say, well, baby, just pray over it for me. Just honestly commit to praying over it. And I will honestly commit to praying over it. And then the Lord would move my heart to be in alignment and agreement with him. For real. So it's just spent in your prayer time. So let's walk in God's wisdom and perfect will. Father, I thank you that the communication of my faith becomes effectual by acknowledging every good thing which is in me in Christ Jesus. I hear the voice of the good shepherd. I hear my Father's voice, and the voice of a stranger I will not follow. Father, I believe in my heart and I say with my mouth that this day the will of God is done in my life. I will walk in a manner worthy of you, Lord, fully pleasing to you and designed to please you in all things, bearing fruit in every good work. Jesus has been made unto me wisdom. I singly, mindedly walk in that wisdom, expecting to know what to do in every situation and to be on top of every circumstance. I roll my works upon you, Lord, and you make my thoughts agreeable to your will. And so my plans are established and succeed. You direct my steps and make them sure. I understand and firmly grasp what the will of the Lord is for I am not vague, thoughtless, or foolish. I stand firm and mature in spiritual growth, convinced and fully assured in everything willed by God. Father, you have destined and appointed me to come progressively to know your will, that is to perceive, to recognize more strongly and clearly, and to become better and more intimately acquainted with your will. I thank you, Father, for the Holy Spirit who abides permanently in me and who guides me into all the truth, the full truth, and speaks whatever he hears from the Father and announces and declares to me the things that are to come. I have the mind of Christ and hold the thoughts, feelings, and purposes of his heart. So, Father, I've entered the blessed rest by adhering, trusting, and relying on you in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to put this confession on my page. I want you to know, when you are out of God's will for his life, I don't know who this is for, but there's a glitch in the system. Like, there's a glitch, like your program has a virus, if that's going to help some of you. When you're out of God's will for your life, your program has a virus, and you may be functioning, but you're operating with a virus. And if you've operated a computer before with a virus, it's sluggish, it's slow, and it has the potential to crash. I don't know who that's for, but I know that's in my spirit. When you are out of God's will for your life, you're operating with the virus. And when you're operating with the virus, you're slow, you're sluggish, and you have the potential to crash. Get in his will for your life. Stop denying what he's told you to do. Hey, go subscribe to my YouTube channel. I've said that 535 times. There's a reason. Go get subscribed to the YouTube channel. Don't forget, we're still working. I'm almost at my goal for taking care of 3 families for Christmas. So if you still want to give, you still have time to give. We're going to present those gifts to this family at the end of the weekend by Monday. So I'm super excited about that. I love you guys so much. Like, I love you more than anything. Go subscribe to LaKisha M. Johnson so you can get the blogs every day. Go follow us on social media. Go add my other page, LMJ Ministries. Share that page with your friends. I love you guys so much. I so enjoy my mornings with you. Like, I so enjoy the mornings. I so enjoy the communication. It's like having a communal devotion. We're all sitting at the table eating together, and I enjoy having this time with you before the Lord. I love you so much. Like, I want to stretch and give you a big oh, wait a minute. My grandson was born yesterday. This was Logan Anthony. Was born yesterday. He was 6 pounds and 11 ounces. He and mom is doing very, very well. I'm so excited. This is my fourth grandson. So I have four under four. Shiloh, Lyric, Zayden, and now Logan Anthony. So I'm super excited and I can't wait to get to Texas to see. Yeah, my birthday is this weekend. So I just said that was my early birthday gift. My birthday is this weekend. So I'm super excited about having a new little grandson. My lineage is strong. My daughter-in-law was like, why can't we produce a girl? And my son keeps telling her, I'm too much man to produce a girl. It's too much testosterone in me. So I'm Nene. That's what they call me. Nene is super excited. So just pray that her body be restored. Pray for baby Logan, that he reach every developmental milestone in his life. I cannot wait to get my hands on him. So love you guys so much. See you back here in the morning where we're going to finish up this two-part series on dealing with the giants in your life. Love, peace, and blessings.